So we've gone through a very detailed example of a data dependence in our five-stage pipeline, and we concluded that if you have a producing instruction, then the consumer has to be delayed by at least two cycles. You need this gap to make sure that the write into the register file happens before the read out of the register file. Okay, so this introduces bubbles in the pipeline, or it introduces stalls, which hurts my IPC. So to overcome this problem, I'm going to introduce this technique called forwarding or bypassing. Okay, so let's go through an example. Again, I'm going to assume the same example where we're doing R1 plus R2, writing the result into R3. And you know, let's say that the values were, you know, that there was 5 in R1, there was 7 in R2, so I'm producing the result 12 into R3. And then my consuming instruction is trying to do R3 plus R4, writing the result into R5. So I want to take, you know, 12 from R3. Let's say R4 is 9, so I want to produce the result 21. Okay, so I look at my first instruction. At this point, I have read R1 and R2 from the register. So I've saved 5 and 7 over here. This is where I do 5 plus 7. I produce the result 12, which is saved in this latch. Then it just moves from one latch to the next and gets saved over here. And then finally it gets written into the register R3. For my consuming instruction, if I were to let it start in the second cycle, this is where I read out of R3 and R4. Okay, R4 has the value 9. If I were to read R3 at this point, I'm going to get some old and outdated value. Let's say that value is 75. So that is what gets saved in this latch. Okay, so now in the next stage, if I were to let this proceed again, I would end up doing 75 plus 9, which is not what I want. What I want is 12 plus 9. Now, is there any way I could have replaced the 75 with a 12? Right, the value 12 is actually sitting somewhere in my pipeline. It's sitting right over here. Okay, so if I had been smart, I could have taken this value 12 and fed it into this ALU, and I could have ended up doing 12 plus 9. Okay, so how do I make that happen, right? So before I do that, let me first number all of my latches, right? So I have a latch way up front which has my program counter, so that's my latch number 1. Then I have latch 2, latch 3, latch 4, latch 5, and then let's say there's another latch which saves some state, so latch 6. So there are 6 latches in my system, right? All these other gray boxes are just reincarnations of those same 6 latches, right? So latch 2, for example, stores instruction 1 at the end of cycle 1. The same latch 2 stores instruction 2 at the end of cycle 2, and so on. Okay, so this is basically latch 2, this is latch 3, latch 4, latch 5, and so on. Okay, so now let me just kind of amplify what is going on over here, right? So I have my ALU, and it gets its input from the previous stage. And now I'm going to introduce options over here, right? I'm allowing myself to get an input either from the 75, or I'm allowing myself to get an input from this 12, right? So I'm introducing a multiplexer over here, which says, you know, I can get my input from one of multiple locations. I will finally pick one of these options. So one of my inputs comes from here. It's the 75, which is being read from latch 3, right? So latch 3 is my usual point of input, right? This ALU got its input from here, which means it got its input from latch 3. Okay? And what I'm saying over here is I could also possibly get my input from here, which is latch 4. So I'm giving myself two options, and there is a control signal over here which decides which of these inputs I'm going to take. This control signal is coming from my decode stage, right? I said my decode stage is the smarts in my pipeline. It is where I analyze my sequence of instructions. It is where I try to figure out who is the producer, who is the consumer, and so on, right? So this decode stage over here would have figured out that if I were to read the value from the register file, I would get some old value of R3. But instead, if I got the value from L4, I would be proceeding with the correct value that was produced by the previous instruction. So the decode stage says that in my next cycle, my ALU should get its input from L4. And so it sends a signal over here that says, you know, pick the L4 input and feed that to the ALU, right? So the L3 input is saying 75, L4 input is saying 12. Instead of feeding 75, let's feed 12 in, and that allows me to do 12 plus 9 here. Okay, so this is how I am bypassing the register file, and this is how the producer is forwarding the value that is sitting in one of its latches to the input of the next instruction. Okay, and this is called forwarding and bypassing, and this allows me to have the producer and consumer issue in back-to-back cycles, right? So these two instructions start in back-to-back cycles and they finish one after another without introducing any bubbles or stalls. So I've saved the two cycles that I lost in my previous example. Okay, let's continue with this example again. Let's assume that R3 plus R4 was actually happening in this third cycle. Let's say it began its execution in the third cycle. Okay, so now when I get to the ALU stage, this is where I want to do, you know, 12 plus 9. What I read from R3 in this case is again the old values. There's 75 sitting in this latch. This is my L3 latch, this is my L4 latch, L4 latch, and so on. Okay, so at this point, again, I don't want to take the input from L3. I want the value 12. Where is 12? It is currently sitting in latch L5, and I want to take this as input. Okay, so what this means is if there's a gap of one cycle between the producer and consumer, the input I need is actually sitting in L5. So I need L5 to be another input into my mux. And again, the decode stage will figure this out. If the value is being produced by the very previous instruction, you should get your input from L4. If the value is being produced by an instruction that issued one cycle earlier, you should get your input from L5. If you need a value that's being produced by an instruction that issued at least two cycles prior, then you should get your input from L3, which is the valid register entry. Okay, so the decoder stage figures out how it can get the value from some latch sitting in the pipeline, and it's able to control this multiplexer which feeds the ALU. Okay, so again, this instruction R3 plus R4, which began in the third cycle, can proceed without any stall cycles. Okay, and I'm showing you the details of this organization over here, the ALU with the mux before it, with multiple inputs coming from various latches, and the control signal which comes from the decode stage. Okay, so to explain this further, let me just go through a few more examples. So here's another example where I have an add which does R2 plus R3, produces the result into R1. And this next instruction is trying to read R1. And what I want to figure out is how many stall cycles do I have to introduce between these two instructions, or can they issue back to back? So if I try to issue them back to back, you know, let's see what is the point of production and what is the point of consumption. Right, so at what point do I know the value that is going to be placed in R1? In this case, I will do R2 plus R3 here. So at this point, I know the result that I want to put away. So this is my point of production. Now let's look at the dependent instruction. It's going to start in the cycle, and what it wants to do is it wants to do 8 plus R1. So over here is where I want to do R1 plus 8. So this is my point of consumption. At this point, I need to know what the value of R1 is. Since the point of consumption is after the point of production, you're good, right? These two instructions can actually issue in back-to-back cycles. Let's take a second example. Here's a value that does a load into R1. Okay, so in this ALU stage, I will do R2 plus 8. That gives me an address, so it says that the location that I'm interested in is right here in data memory. Now I will read out of that location and produce the value that gets stored into R1. So this is the point of production. At this point, I know what is the value that's going to go into R1. So this is my point of production. Okay, so if I look at the second instruction, let's say it starts in this cycle. It needs to do R1 plus 8 in the ALU stage. So this is my, you know, point of consumption. If I were to let the second instruction proceed, the point of consumption is happening before the point of production. This is not going to work. So I have to introduce a stall cycle. The decode stage has to figure out that if I let myself proceed, I will work with the wrong result. So let me stall this instruction for a cycle. Let me repeat the decode process again here. And here's when I figure out that now it's safe to move forward. So now if I move forward, I will do R1 plus 8 here. This is now my point of consumption. And this is after the point of production, so now it will work just fine, right? So I had to introduce one stall cycle between the two. And this is because the point of production was one cycle later than my previous example. Here my point of production was the fourth stage, whereas before the point of production was the third stage. Okay, now let's take another example, and this time I'm going to change the point of consumption. right? And this is being caused by a store instruction. So the first, the producing instruction is like before. It's going to produce the value R1 over here. So this is the point of production where R1 is finally known. The store instruction first needs to do 8 plus R3. If I let it proceed in this stage, it'll do R3 plus 8 right here. So this is the point of consumption for R3. And then when I get to the data memory stage, that's when the result R1 is going to be written into that address, right? This is a store. It has two input operands. It has R3 as an input operand and R1 as an input operand. R3 gets consumed over here and R1 gets consumed over here. So this is the point of consumption for R1. And now this point of consumption does happen after the point of production, so you could proceed with zero stall cycles. Okay, so this guy, if you look at two instructions and you want to figure out if you have to introduce stalls or not, you have to figure out the point of production and the point of consumption for the consuming instruction. And you have to figure out if you have to introduce stalls such that the point of consumption is after the point of production. So this is kind of summarized over here. You know, this instruction, point of production is the third stage. If that is the case, then there are zero stall cycles. Or in this case, point of production is fourth stage, but point of consumption is also the fourth stage. So in this case, again, zero stall cycles. And in this case, point of production is fourth stage. The point of consumption is the third stage. And if that is the case, then you have to introduce one stall cycle. Okay, so this summarizes the discussion on bypassing and forwarding. The next video will deal with control hazards.